Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our HDK live streaming church service this morning. Today is the sixth Sunday of Easter. We are almost at another turning point in our liturgical year. Next week we will celebrate Ascension on the Sunday, and then the following week will be Pentecost. So as today is the last day of the Easter, post-Easter season, we start to focus upon the return of Jesus to heaven. And we will hear of that later in our readings this morning. So let us begin our worship in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. To him indeed be the glory, the power, and the honour forever and ever. Amen. May our Lord forever reign. Let's sing that now in the words of our first song.
Nothing good in me. You are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. When my fear is crippling, you are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms, the riches of your love. Will ever see.
Would you join me now in our time of confession and forgiveness? What is our hope? Simply put, it is that God does not give up on us. With such good news, we can dare to bring our prayers to the one who will not cast aside our words or our hearts. Please join me as we pray together, saying, we admit, knowing God, that from plastic cards to websites, from handheld devices to stock options, we are surrounded by a variety of gods who demand our worship. We can all too easily believe that work is our life, that wealth is the reason for our being, and that success is the very air we breathe. Forgive us, God of mercy. You are not found in a computer chip, but in the child who holds our hand. You are not a simple tweet, but the word that can transform our very lives. You are not a disembodied, constantly recalculating voice, but the one who calls us to life through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Despite everything we do, God loves us and forgives us. This grace is why we can dare to hope. We will witness to this hope in every word we speak, to every person we meet. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. Amen. We'll now hear the readings for this morning.
First reading this morning is from Psalm 66, 7 to 19. Psalm 66, 7 to 19. He rules forever by his power. His eyes watch the nations. Let not the rebellious rise up against him. Praise our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. He has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. For you, O God, tested us. You refined us like silver. You brought us into prison and laid burdens on our backs. You let men ride over our heads. We went through fire and water. But you brought us to a place of abundance. I will come to your temple with burnt offerings and fulfill my vows to you, vows my lips promised and my mouth spoke when I was in trouble. I will sacrifice fat animals to you and an offering of rams. I will offer bulls and goats. Come and listen, all you who fear God. Let me tell you what he has done for me. I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God has surely listened and heard my voice in prayer. Our second reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 to 31. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now what you worship as something unknown, I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands, as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Glenda is now going to share with us the kids' chat.
Good morning, everybody. I remember when I was at school, I used to always love it in social studies when we would learn about places like ancient Egypt and ancient Greece and ancient Rome. I don't know whether you still learn about places like that at school. I hope you do, because it's really interesting to look at the ways that people used to live. And, you know, it struck me this morning that actually Paul was there. Paul was in these places that I really liked to read about and to learn about. And we heard a little bit about his experiences in Athens, in Greece, in the reading this morning. An earlier verse, verse 16, says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. And I'm going to read also a little bit more that Heather had read. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this description, to an unknown god. So it's a bit like Paul was a tourist. He was wandering around Athens. He was seeing what it was like and how it was different from other places that he'd been. Imagine all the things he saw, including what he was talking about here, lots and lots of statues of all the gods. So some of the gods that the Greeks worshipped were Demeter. She was the goddess of agriculture, Poseidon, the god of the sea, Aphrodite, the goddess of love, Athena, the goddess of war and wisdom, Apollo, the god of medicine, arts, light, and music. And these statues, they would have been quite impressive. You know, they were built on a plinth, which was like a very solid, quite large foundation. And they would have been really obvious as you were walking around Athens. But were they really gods? Was there really a goddess of agriculture and a god of the sea? Well, no, they're not. Those are just things. There is the sea and there is agriculture. But there's no goddess of agriculture. You know, we're a bit the same sometimes. We put things on plinths and we make them the gods of our lives. Things like appearance. Sometimes the way that we look is becomes so important to us that it stresses us out if our hair's not right or if our clothes aren't the most up-to-date, fashionable clothes that you can buy. What about sport? Sometimes it stops being just a game and we follow our teams religiously. We have to go to every game. We have to watch every game. We have to buy all the merchandise, or we have to go and play the game to the exclusion of everything else. Or being popular. Sometimes do you find that you have to do anything your friends want you to do in order to stay popular? Is it that important to you? Paul went on to explain about our God, about the real God, to the people of Athens. He explained to them that he made the whole world and everything in it, that he is our Father, that he is revealed in Jesus Christ, and that he died and rose again. So who stands on the plinth of your life? Is it you? Are you the most important person in your life? Are you your own God? Or the real God? Do you put Jesus Christ and God the Father and the Holy Spirit on the plinth? And is he the God of your life? God, there is a lot that tempts us in our world. Help us to not make them more important than you. Help us to keep you on that plinth of our lives. Amen.
Let us exalt our God as we sing our next song, Awesome God. Going to pray together the prayer of the day. God, our Redeemer, you have delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that as by his death he has recalled us to life, so by his continual presence in us he may raise us to eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. This morning we want to continue on with the theme verse for today from Acts 17 to 20, 22 to 31 as my sermon text for today. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Lord, we have come before you to indeed exalt you and worship you as God of God, of Lord of Lords, as King of Kings. So come, reign in our hearts and our lives and in our world. And Lord, may the good news of your coming for us, your life, your death, your resurrection in Jesus Christ our Lord, indeed gladden our hearts this day and always. In your precious name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. I began my sermon with this tourism film clip of Athens for you to see the historical setting of our text. It still exists today and you can visit it. What you saw in the clip was the Areopagus and the Parthenon on the Acropolis. It's similar still today to what it was in Paul's day. The Acropolis is the rocky outcrop upon which the Parthenon is built. The temple is dedicated to the patron god Athena, is the Parthenon. And you also saw a metal plaque which has Paul's text of the sermon on top of the Areopagus. And the Areopagus, translated as Hill of Ares or Mars Hill, was the place where Paul first preached this sermon to the Athenians, where he first preached the good news to them. Now, Paul had come to Athens as a result of agitation from the Thessalonian Jews, as a result of him successfully preaching the gospel in Berea. Silas and Timothy stayed on at Berea and Paul waited for them at Athens for them to catch up. Paul was, as he walked around Athens, was distressed at the amount of idolatry that he saw there. As was his usual practice, he went to the synagogue and there tried to show the local Jews the fulfillment of Jesus Christ as the promised Messiah of Israel according to the Old Testament. He also went into the common marketplace of the day, which was the common meeting place of the people, and there also shared the good news. Now, the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers who had heard him speak said that his teaching was babble and that he was advocating foreign gods. They thought that he was speaking about two separate gods in Greek, Jesus and Anastasis, which is in English, Jesus and resurrection. So they took him aside to a quieter place than the Areopagus, which was the Areopagus. And this was the hill on the edge of Athens, where the ruling council of Athens, which took its name from the rocky outcrop, actually met. The Areopagus was the main legal and religious governing council of Athens, with disciplining and punitive powers. Now, Paul was not on trial here, but these leading men of the city wanted to hear more of what he had to say. Paul could see from the Athenians that they were a religious people. They were grasping after God. It was their way of life, but their search led them into idolatry and pagan practices. Their idolatry was not fulfilling because they were always looking for something new, something that would fill that God-shaped hole that was in their lives. Paul had the answer in that sermon that he preached that day at the Areopagus. He preached good news to a grasping world. And as our world is dealing with coronavirus, we see that all of the old gods that people trusted in are unfulfilling and crumbling. COVID-19 has revealed the hollowness of them all. We can learn a lot from Paul's sermon to the Athenians to face the current spiritual climate of our world, as it's also time for us Christians to share good news for a grasping world. And this is the theme of my sermon today. Now, in his sermon, Paul begins by acknowledging that the Athenians are very religious. But the Greek word here is ambiguous. It can also mean very superstitious. And the Jews would have understood that word as fear of the demonic. Paul had looked carefully at their objects of worship and settled on one, the altar to the unknown God. Paul said, "What you worship is something unknown. I am going to proclaim," meaning he was going to make known that God to you. The late missiologist Don Richardson, in his book Eternity in Their Hearts, tells the fascinating story of the altar to the unknown God based on historical documents and sources that he cites in his book. The story begins sometime in the 6th century BC with the city of Athens being devastated by a mysterious plague. When no explanation for the plague could be found and no cure was in sight, the approach was to assume that one of the city's many gods had been offended. The leaders had sought to determine which of the local gods had been offended, and they wanted to appease that god. This was no easy task, since the city of Athens literally had hundreds of gods. When all efforts failed to discern which god had been offended, an outside consultant was brought in from the Isle of Cyprus. His name was Epimenides. Epimenides concluded that it was none of the known gods of Athens which had been offended, but yet some unknown god. He proposed a course of action which, if it worked, would at least provide a possible remedy for the plague. He got a flock of choice sheep of many different colours. He kept them from food until they were hungry. And then on a given day, he had the sheep turned loose in the area on Mars Hill and around it, which was a very succulent pasture back in those days. For any sheep not to have eaten his fill would have been unexplainable. He had the sheep turned loose and watched carefully to see if any of the sheep would lie down and not eat, even though hungry and in prime grazing. Several sheep, to the amazement of those who were watching, did lie down, and altars were erected at each of the spots where the sheep laid down, and there that sheep was sacrificed to the unknown God. And almost immediately it was said that the plague lifted from Athens. Over a period of time, the altars were forgotten and began to deteriorate, but one altar was restored and preserved for the people of Athens to always remember the removal of the plague by calling upon the unknown God. And this story, as was typical in antiquity, was told from generation to generation. The Athenians would have known why there was an altar to the unknown God who had healed them of the plague. They only had an altar to him and not an image because he was unknown. They didn't know what he was like. Now Paul was going to make him known. And Paul firstly declares the unknown God to be the Creator God, The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by hands. Quoting the Old Testament to these people would have been of no use because they didn't know the scriptures. But they did know life. They are alive and they know about the spiritual realm of the gods. The natural realm is something that we all live in and all have in common. Such a God with the ability to be able to create the heavens and the world and everything in it and rules, that is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by human hands. Such a vast God cannot be contained. Even sophisticated Greeks would have understood that the divine nature could not be contained even in the most magnificent temple. So Paul declares that the unknown God is the creator God and he is uncontainable. Secondly, Paul says he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything because he gives all men life and breath and everything else. The unknown God is not a God who has an insatiable appetite for the sacrifices of the people. In fact, there is nothing that you can give him because he owns everything. All that we have as humans, he gives to us. And he gives it to us from his kindness, his goodness, his benevolence. We do not need to continually placate him so that we don't sort of get it in the neck. Our life, our world, our living is a gift from this Creator God to us. Thirdly, Paul said, from one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. The unknown God created humanity out of one man. Paul is preaching Adam without referring to Adam. As God created all people from one common God-designed ancestor, all people, therefore, are created equal. The earth is created as a home for all the human family. The times and places mean that God is king and he appoints when and where people live in their national family groups. And because they have one common ancestor, no one is better than the other. No nation is greater than another. All were created for relationship with each other. But not only relationship with each other, but also relationship with the Creator God. Paul says, God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. For in him we live and move and have our being is a line from a poem written by Epimenides in the 6th century. Now you've heard his name already in the story of the sheep and the sacrifices this morning. And we are his offspring is from a poem by Aretas in the 3rd century BC. Paul says there is a desire in the heart of the unknown God to relate to all people. He designed this creation in such a way that this relationship could occur. Just as a lost child searches for its parents, there's a God-shaped hole in all people that drives them towards looking for their Creator God. But the Creator God is not hiding from them. If anything, they are actually hiding from him in their practice of idolatry, in worshipping creation, and in making gods in their own image. This is why Paul says, therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone in an image made by man's design and skill. Because what is the truth of the matter? And once again, Paul is preaching Genesis without quoting Genesis. If all humanity is God's offspring, therefore we are created in his image. Humanity is the image of God, not a carved or moulded idol made of natural material, such as wood or silver or gold. And the image of a bird or a bull or the thousand and one other created images they have cannot be the image of God. So what the Athenians heard from this sermon of Paul was that firstly, the unknown God that Paul is making known is above all other gods. He is the creator of all humankind, and he is uncontainable. Secondly, that he is kind and generous and benevolent and does not need to be appeased or manipulated by sacrificial worship. Thirdly, that God created all people equal in his image from one common God-designed ancestor. As such, this means that all people should live together in peace and harmony as family. And this Creator God desires to have a relationship with us as children do to their parents. We are his offspring. And finally, to create idols representing him is an abomination, as human beings are those who are created in his image. Now, this new teaching that Paul would have been presenting to the Athenians would have done their heads in. For they believe that the Creator God set this world in motion and then moved to the outer edges of the galaxy, never to be involved again. Secondly, they believe that as Greeks, they were better than the others, the barbarians. As Athenians, they also believe that they were better than the other Greeks. They hadn't come to Athens from immigration, but came up out of the soil. They would have been offended at Paul saying that God does not need anything, as they believe that their gods needed to be appeased and worshipped by their sacrifices, or else they would be punished. And to speak against the fashioning of idols in the image of God undermined the whole of Athenian society in all its dimensions. But it was Paul's last point of teaching that was the most radical and offensive. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. You see, God had been willing to wink at the ignorance of their idolatry in the past. But now an event occurred in human history that makes this possible no more. And this is that the unknown God has now been made known. He has been made known in Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God, the Messiah of Israel, the perfect image of God. And because of this revelation, no longer can humanity speculate about God or his standards of righteousness. Through Jesus, God will judge the world in righteousness. And the proof of his appointment as judge is that God raised him from the dead. When the political and religious leaders of the day did their best to get rid of him, God overruled them and raised Jesus from the dead. Now was the time for the people of Athens to right their wrongs and turn their hearts to God in Jesus Christ. Time is limited. The judge has arrived. They must decide whether to commit themselves to the truth or not. It can't be a mere mental exercise. It is a life and death manner that settles their relationship with God and sets their eternal destiny. So Paul called them to repent, to change their minds of all their religious systems and philosophical systems and turn to Jesus Christ. Well, as a result, some sneered, some wanted to hear more, and a few believed. Resurrection is firmly ruled out according to the ground rules of the Areopagus. One of the ancient beliefs of the Areopagus was when a man dies and his blood is spilled on the ground, there is no resurrection. But the truth is that resurrection is actually the fulcrum which the world turns. In the resurrection, God's new world begins. Resurrection is the start, the foundation, the beginning of the great setting aright, which God will do for the whole of creation at the end. It is through Jesus Christ that everything will be set right. I do not believe that arguments from silence can be preached as truth, but I find it fascinating that on Mars Hill, those present may have interpreted the unknown God who saved the city from the plague 600 years ago was actually our God the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. If we can accept that historical scenario, it's interesting then as we face another plague, as many have called COVID-19, we also see that the world, the gods of this world, have been unable to sustain us or bring us cure. All of the world's gods that people have trusted in have failed or are failing. Health and wealth and happiness, consumerism, materialism, conservatism, liberalism, sex, power, technology, fashion, stardom, atheism, agnosticism, politics. Yes, there's still a God-shaped hole in everyone's life, a hole many have been looking to fill with the wrong God. And maybe at the moment the time is just right for we Christians to speak the good news to this grasping world, a world that is becoming more desperate as the cure for COVID-19 has not been found. And as people lose their jobs, their businesses, their wealth, their possessions, as their old gods fail them, they need to know that there is one that can make good of this chaos. And this God is the God who is above all the other gods. He is creator of all and uncontainable. He is kind, generous, and benevolent, and willing to help and to give. He has created all people to live together as in harmony, as family, for we are created in his image. Therefore, as the saying goes, we are all in this together. He desires to have relationship with us as children do to their parents. We are his offspring. Most of all, this God has made himself known to us in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who bore the wounds of all the sins and plagues and false gods when he died on the cross and proved that they have not power when he rose again on the third day. By his resurrection, we are guaranteed a hope and a future. It's time to repent. For the unbelieving and distracted people, it's time for them to turn to the living God, to change their minds about where they are going and what they are doing with their lives as they serve all of these other gods. In the midst of this coronavirus, we have good news to share with a grasping world. The unknown God made known, Jesus Christ. Amen. So indeed, Lord Jesus, we thank you as your people that you have made yourself known to us through your dying and rising again. Lord, as we live in this world infected by a plague, COVID-19, let us indeed, O God, rise up as Paul did on the Areopagus and proclaim, O God, who you really are and how you have been truly revealed in Jesus Christ, and you have help for all people in the midst of this chaos. And that despite what is going on around us, Lord, we can have a hope and a future because of our faith in you. So help us as your people, O God, to share the good news in a grasping world. In your precious name we pray, Lord Jesus, the unknown God made known. Amen. We now sing the hymn, The Church's One Foundation. Would you join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Wayne is now going to lead us in our prayers.
Heavenly Father, we give thanks at this time for the guidance of our leaders and medical staff. Help us all to continue to follow the advice and to keep safe. We give thanks for all that you have given us, Lord. Strengthen us to follow your way in caring for those who are in need. Remember all of those who are struggling at this time and all who might need your healing hands. We pray, Lord, for the time that we can come back together and to worship you. We pray, Lord, after this time of COVID-19 and lockdowns, people will continue to value a quieter, more reflective time to focus on you, the unknown God, that we can come to know you as our God, and that people can have a relationship with you. Let us follow Jesus, our living God, turn our hearts to him, to follow his way of grace, hope, and love. I wonder, Lord, what you are calling me to do this week, to share the message of Jesus Christ and all that he's taught us. As our Saviour, Jesus Christ, has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
We have some birthdays this week. On the 20th is Richard Meyer, Iris von Bonnen and Christine Wallner. On the 21st of May, Elizabeth Owers and Lynn Wenzel. And on the 23rd of May, Joan Blake. And also on the 19th of May, Barry and Dee Lister are celebrating their anniversary. So we extend to you our love and prayers and God's richest blessings for your days of celebration. At the beginning of the service, I shared with you that on this Easter 6th Sunday, we normally start to focus about the return of Christ and the Ascension. Ascension Day is this Thursday night. And so normally on the Sunday before, we think about Christ leaving the disciples to die upon the cross in the context of him leaving the disciples to return to heaven. And as such, the gospel reading for today is from John chapter 14, verses 15 to 21. And we say, glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey what I command, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. And this is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I struggled to find a song as suitable for this context because we're thinking about the disciples being told by Jesus to love one another, and that's how he would be actually revealed and the Father would be revealed through their love for each other while he returned to heaven. But I found one, and it's an old one that you, many of you who were teenagers back in the 60s might remember. It was a song by the Youngbloods, and it was called Get Together. And it has a verse in it that says, some may come and some may go, we will surely pass when the one that left us here returns for us at last. We are but a moment's sunlight fading in the grass. So let's think of our call to love one another in the light of our Lord's ascension as we sing together the song, Get Together.
Try to love one another right.
Jesus said that they will know that you are my disciples by your love for one another. So in the power of that love, as you go out into this broken and hurting world, share that love of God through this week. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. We're going to finish with the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. So as I said earlier in the service, next week we will celebrate Ascension Day. Next Sunday, the readings will be for Ascension Day. And we will remember our Lord's ascension into heaven and what that means for us. Last Friday, we had some easing of restrictions here at in Queensland. What this means for us as church is basically that we're going to look at, not this week, but the following week, reopening the church again from 9:30 to 12. Deb will be here and the office will be open and you'll be able to come into the church. And I'm sure many of you have missed just the church building, because there is something in our psyche that is blessed by a sacred space. So you'll be welcome to come into the church during that time and just soak in the atmosphere, have some prayer. Of course, there will be a minimum of 10 people at any time allowed for that. But we're looking at opening the church again. We'll be able to have our prayer group here, because there are less than 10 people in that. Other than that, it's advised that still everybody who is 70 and over and in the vulnerable categories still should remain at home. As yet, there is to be no Eucharist celebrated at a public worship service, nor is there private communion to be given except in necessary circumstances. Not this week, but of course the week after, I'm going to be having 6 days off, and so Deb and Janet will look after the management of the place. Clenda has a new position down as the library down at Caboolture, and so she has a week off between finishing her old job here at Caloundra and before she starts down at Caboolture, so we're having a few days off together while we can. I'll tell you more about everything tomorrow in the newsletter. Also, something that you might be interested in is concerning our finances. Deb has done the finances for April, and it seems that we're probably down about 25%, which overall is pretty good considering we normally are given about $12,000 a month, and so we have $9,000 for April, and so we're holding fairly solidly at the moment, which is good news. So God bless you, and may you have a wonderful week, and indeed go in the love of the Lord and share that love with all whom you meet. God bless you. Look forward to sharing with you again next Sunday.